This episode of the Modern Therapist Survival Guide is brought to you by The Therapist Leader.
The Therapist Leader was created to assist therapists developing their businesses beyond the one-to-one model in a strategic and sustainable way. Zoe has a three-pronged approach of refining, scaling, and leading your practice.
Listen at the end of the episode for more information and how to get your free CEO workbook and accompanying e-course from The Therapist Leader.
You're listening to the Modern Therapist Survival Guide, where therapists live, breathe, and practice as human beings. To support you as a whole person and a therapist, here are your hosts, Curt Widhalm and Katie Vernoy.
Welcome back, Modern Therapists. This is the Modern Therapist Survival Guide. I'm Curt Widhalm with Katie Vernoy. And as always, thank you for being a listener. And if you do us a favor, and wherever you listen to us, if you wouldn't mind going there, leaving us a rating and a review. And if you're not yet a subscriber, please subscribe. All of that definitely helps us out in our rankings and people being able to find us. And awkward segue, that's what this whole episode's about, is getting found and improving your rankings. And we've done SEO stuff before. It's come kind of from people from the tech background. So today, very exciting to be joined by Dr. Rachna Jain. She has profitable popularity as her company, and she is a mental health person first who has this SEO thing figured out. And thank you so much for joining us. We're really happy to have you here today.
Thanks. I'm really excited to be here. I was looking forward to it.
I am really excited because we've had a couple of conversations, and it's always amazing to find people who have really dug deep into a kind of second craft, right? Something where you really have identified ways to help, not just with SEO, but also with reputation, online reputation. There's just so many pieces to what you do. So I'm going to let you tell us who you are and what you're putting out into the world.
Absolutely. So I'm a psychologist. I have a doctor of psychology, clinical psychology. I have been in practice for a little over 20 years, which makes me sound so old. I have been offering SEO and online marketing services to clients since 2003. I have been using the internet to fill my psychology practice as early as 1998, which was practically the start of the internet. So how I got started was putting up a very ugly one-page website that I built myself, which I would not recommend anymore. But at the time, you had to do, you know, what you had to do. And I put up that one-page website, and I taught myself search engine optimization. Now, it was very different then. It was a lot easier because there were only about, you know, 100 websites on the entire internet. So that made it, you know, fairly easy. But I did get top ranking. I was able to generate calls to my my practice. And then I did that for a few years, and it was right at the beginning of managed care, and there was that whole kind of managed care piece. And maybe like many of the listeners at that time, I didn't have a lot of background in business, so I wasn't really sure how to create, you know, a fee-for-service practice. I was actually very, very shy at the time, so I was afraid to market myself as well. I did try some networking, which didn't go very well. Because every time I would meet people and I'd say I was a psychologist, they didn't seem to want to talk to me anymore. That was about it. Yeah, that was about it. But then in 2003, people started to approach me and started to ask me, you know, how do you get clients from the internet? And I said, oh, well, you do this and you do that and you do this other thing. And they said, I don't want to do it myself. I want you to do it for me. And so I took on a handful of clients in a very exploratory kind of experimental way. They had very, very good results. And then I realized that this was actually a lot of fun. I really enjoyed it. And that I brought something interesting to the search engine optimization space, because many of the companies that offer SEO services are extremely technical. They don't always understand the delicate balancing act of balancing a professional service business, such as being a psychotherapist or a psychologist, with the advertising and promotion of online marketing. And so I believe that I bring kind of a unique understanding of both because I've done both and I do both.
I like the idea that you have these two different pieces, because no matter what you tell me, I'm not going to believe that SEO isn't technical. But I think there is something that happens that, or something that can happen where people that don't understand not just service-based businesses, but highly trusted service professionals needing to have some special parameters around the way they present themselves online. And so what do you see as the things that are really unique to therapists or other highly trusted professionals when they are in that marketing space, and what needs to be considered?
That's a great question. I think that the things that need to be considered are this persona or the manner in which you present yourself. There needs to be a congruence and a consistency between how you present yourself and how you are in person. I believe that the capacity to specialize can help you a great deal in online marketing. So more than being a generalist, even if you see everyone and really could help everyone, the more that you can kind of specialize and articulate your specialties, that can be really helpful. And I also think that it really is important as a professional to understand where your areas of expertise are and where they're not, both clinically, but then also in terms of online marketing. So one of the big debates is whether therapists can do their SEO themselves. And anytime I meet people and they find out what I do, the audience splits, and you know, about 50% say, well, I do all of my own SEO and I've done a great job. And the other 50% says, ooh, I don't want to do that at all. That sounds horrible. And I think it's important to understand where you land on that continuum. And doing your own SEO, you know, has benefits, of course, but it also has difficulties, you know. And if you're not that comfortable with technology, or it's just not your forte, or it's not something that you're going to spend time tracking, taking care of your online reputation if you get a bad review, which can happen. You know, it could be an issue with that particular client. It could be something about the patient's character, you know, or relational issues. It could just be a lot of different things. And if you don't even know it's there, it will be directly impacting your business. So if it's my sort of best advice is that if you're going to do it yourself, that you really do it in the same way that a professional would do it for you. And if you're not able or willing or don't want to make that commitment, then it's something better to leave to people who, you know, who can do it for you.
How has SEO really changed, and really for therapists over the last 15, 20 years that your experience has been? Because I imagine it's a lot more than putting just like, you know, trauma therapist on the front page of a website now. There's a lot more that goes into this. And how are you seeing the successes of people or the work that you do that goes into really helping get the results that people are looking for out of being able to create that cohesive brand?
Absolutely. So there were several parts to that question. Let me kind of break that down.
I know the question kind of went on for like 2 minutes. One of the longest questions.
I want a history and I want best practices. Right now.
Got it. So in terms of history, well, I'd say one of the biggest ways that the internet has changed just generally is the sheer volume of websites that are online now compared to when I started, or, you know, a few years after. You know, I made a joke earlier, I made a reference to there only being about 100 websites on the internet, but that actually was true at one point. You know, that was true. And now I don't remember exactly what the numbers are, but they say that something like 6,000 new websites go up every hour or something.
I mean, it's
a very, very high number. And so that's been one of the biggest changes. The competition is a lot more. You know, when I first started doing SEO, I was one of the only therapists in the area who knew anything about the internet. So I had a big advantage that when people started to use the internet, I had already put my website at the top of the search engines for my areas of specialization. So there was a lot less competition. It was a lot easier to do. You know, you made kind of a joke, Curt, but it was true. It used to be that you could just put trauma therapist and then your city, and you would rank on the first page for that. What has changed, though, is with the rise of Google AdWords, the top three positions are now taken by ads or can be taken by ads. So that means with organic search, which is the process of naturally ranking in the search engines, you're going to be, you know, number four on the page after those first three ads. So you're not going to be number one right at the top of the page unless there's no competition at all for that term, and then you don't really want to be optimizing for it. Then the second change has been the introduction of the Google Maps listings, which have further pushed down the organic search listings. If you go and you see Google Maps, you'll have three ads, you'll have between three and five map listings. So that means the top organic search is already going to be number nine on the page. And then the third change has been the rise of all of the therapist directory locators that are the aggregates of people's information, and people can go to these directories. Many times those occupy the top organic search or the first organic ranking because they have so many pages that all reference psychology or therapy, you know, something. So you have all of these changes that are all designed to make it more difficult to gain ranking organically and to benefit from the ranking. Now, that being said, in a less competitive city or town, it's still possible to rank highly and do fine. If you are working in a larger metropolitan area, or you're very ambitious, you plan to have a multi-clinician center, or you plan to have multiple multi-clinician centers, that's going to take more work. I have one client who I've been working with for many years, and she works in a very competitive metropolitan area that's also very large. And what we saw in doing her SEO is that the longer we've done it, the better her results have been. So maybe 2 years ago, she was getting about 50 calls a month from the search engines, even for all of the ads, all of the Google Maps listings, and all of the different things I already mentioned. And now, the longer she's done SEO, she has been getting over 100 calls a month. And she's very ambitious. She has multiple multi-clinician centers. So that is a very good inflow for her. But I think that for not every therapist would that be the right number of calls. That would be too many, and many would go to waste because there may be a smaller practice or they don't have as many clinicians. So it's also important to kind of right size your SEO efforts to the size of your business, whether you do it yourself or someone does it for you.
There's a couple of things that stand out in what you're saying to me. Number one is, of course, an SEO expert is going to advise that you need to buy multiple years of services of SEO. But there's also a point in there that this isn't just kind of a do it once and set it and forget it sort of thing.
That's absolutely right. And yes, of course, an SEO expert's going to do that. But the adjustment I'd make to that is that process of her continually reinvesting has been happening very organically. And what I mean by that is she gets results and then chooses to reinvest. Right. She gets more results and then chooses to reinvest. So in no case ever, in my business, do I ever lock people into multi-year contracts until we get results for them. And then by the time we're getting results, they're often very happy to continue services because the results are that meaningful for them.
Well, and I think it's something where the other piece that I want to highlight that you were saying is kind of right-sizing your SEO efforts. And I think in a conversation that we've had before in talking about the scale of what you do or the types of support that you can provide to someone in the online space, you're wanting someone that has that scale. You want someone that is going to have either a multi-clinician practice or like what we were talking about, many different, is kind of creating a larger personal brand where they're wanting those hits for other products and services, other big types of things where there's a big push. And I think to me, what I'm really hearing is that SEO may not be for everyone because, you know, or a high level of SEO may not be for everyone because if someone has a solo practice and they're doing networking and it's working, or they're doing some Google AdWords and that they're pleased with that and kind of like to turn it on and off versus having this constant kind of rising in the rankings, there may be other solutions that are more appropriate. And so I just wanted to comment on that.
Yes, there absolutely are. That's a great point. There absolutely are other solutions. And in fact, I would not recommend SEO for a new business, pretty much in any case. So a therapy practice that's less than maybe a year or two old. And I know I said that, unless you have a special reason, like you're very shy to market yourself like I was, then, you know, because SEO does take a while to, it takes a few months to get ranking in most cases. And you have to be able to keep your business running while you're investing in SEO, whether you do it yourself or someone does it for you, to be able to afford to continue the investment, because as Curt pointed out, it is something that is cumulative or accretive, where the more you do it, the more benefits you ultimately get. So yes, SEO is not for everyone. And if your networking is working great, if you have a strong community already, a strong set of referral sources, you may never need SEO. You know, I think the solo practitioner can benefit from it. I do think that their upside for it, though, does have a ceiling that will be reached faster. Because if you only need, you know, two or three more clients, you probably could get that from the network you have. If you need 10 more, 15 or 20 more, or you have a lot of client attrition for some reason, maybe you do brief therapy and they're cured and they're out of there, you know, then it's a different situation. But I do think it's important when you're considering working with someone for SEO, you want to be sure that, you know, that your practice meets certain criteria. And so if it's okay, I can share with you kind of what I look for in clients that I work with. I look for clients that have a desire to grow and have space to grow, so that either they're newer to some degree and they have a lot of availability, or they're about to ramp up from being half-time to full-time. I look for people who have strong clinical skills and they have some record documentation for themselves of good client retention, because the biggest benefit of SEO comes in the compounding factor. And the compounding factor is when you get, you know, two clients in the first month, two clients in the second month, three clients in the third month, four clients in the fourth month. And if you're able to retain them, you'll start to see that your income increases steadily. SEO does not work if you don't, if you're not good at retaining clients, because you'll basically just have a churn and burn where they come in and they leave, they come in and they leave, and it becomes very expensive on multiple levels as a way to run your business. And then the third thing I look for after that is, you know, they have capacity, they have retention. I also try to work with people who have a high enough fee that even if they only get two or three clients a month from SEO, which is sort of, you know, the bottom most number, that it would still be profitable for them. So if you're doing sliding scale or you're doing a lot of insurance, you want to kind of look at the numbers for yourself before you look at investing in SEO. But if you do fee for service and you have good client retention and you have capacity, whether your own or hiring clinicians, it can be a very strong strategy.
How, over the course of these months of working on it, do people see that cumulative effect? I wonder about, you know, how effective is the blog on somebody's website? How much is them posting on Twitter or Facebook or Instagram helping their website improve in the rankings and having people find them in the general Google search rankings?
So there are more than 200 factors that go into gaining ranking on Google.
Just that.
I think the last number was something like 213, maybe and a half, but it was 213
oh,
factors.
Wow.
Yeah. Okay. And so those are all, you know, it basically is that if all of that adds up to what the Google algorithm is, you would say that it's, you know, 1% of this, 3% of that, 6% of that. So for example, blogging is a certain percentage. Social signals such as from Twitter or Instagram or Facebook is a certain percentage. Whether you have a Google Maps listing and you're a local business is a certain percentage. If you fill in your Maps listing, your Google My Business page fully, that gives you, you know, a little bit of percentage. So all of the factors are not weighted equally. The thing about it is that there's sort of a core set of items that every therapist business, you know, wants to have in place just to have good presence online. And then there's more that can be done with those items once they're in place if they're looking to have greater ranking or, you know, or to grow their business from the internet. And I can share what those are in just a second. The kind of aspect of that is that, you know, that blogging itself is not necessarily a client generation strategy. Blogging is very useful for SEO for several reasons. It's one of the factors that contributes in those 213 factors. And so the reason it's valuable is because it makes your website more authoritative because you have more content on it. The second is that it keeps your website fresh because you have updated content. Your website wasn't just built and left static. The third thing is that I think of every blog post as a little bit like a beacon that is out there on the internet. So when I work with people and I help them develop a blog posting strategy, I suggest to them that part of their content be kind of what we call evergreen. So it deals with, you know, what is anxiety, symptoms of anxiety, curing anxiety, for example. And then there are trending topics or fad topics. So if there's a new anxiety cure, that they should write a blog post about that. If a big celebrity story breaks where somebody admits they have, you know, incredible anxiety, they should write a story about that. So that when people are going online in their area and they're searching for that celebrity and their anxiety, their website has a chance of coming up. So there are a lot of different ways to create the content and use the content in a way that's beneficial. The blogging for itself, like people say, well, I wrote a blog or I started a blog and then I abandoned it. That's don't do that. It's not worth it, you know? And I don't think it's worth blogging necessarily unless it is within the context of an SEO strategy, unless you just like to write or you're trying to create a body of work for some other reason. So I think that blogging is extremely powerful in SEO for multiple reasons. There may not be a ton of need to do it if you're not going to do an SEO process.
I think that's probably a relief to some people because I think some people are like, I have to blog because it's a marketing strategy. And I think that there is a small element of that, but it sounds like there really is more of this piece of being very strategic around the beacon back to the website.
It absolutely is. And the thing is if it comes down to writing an article or going to a meeting where you're actually going to meet people face to face, always go to the meeting where you meet people face to face. It's much more likely to result in some improvements to your business.
One thing that we kind of have barely mentioned, but I think is something that Curt and I kind of tried to talk about a while back. If we framed it about Yelp reviews or about, you know, kind of how do we manage our online reputation? And I know that's also an area of expertise for you. And I think this is something where it's like, okay, I love everything you're saying. I want to pick your brain about every single topic that I can. But when a therapist has a bad review or when they have some sort of something come out online that really can impact their reputation, with the issues of confidentiality, with the issues of so many pieces of our ethics code and the laws that frame our profession, what are our options? How do we manage an online reputation in an effective way as we're building this, you know, kind of this beacon of here I am, here's all my stuff, like, you know, a bad Yelp review or something on, you know, Facebook or whatever it is, like there can be this big stain.
Absolutely. So the laws are different in the different states as far as promoting yourself, responding to feedback online. So I'm not an expert in every single state, but generally what I would say a good strategy for any professional service provider is to own the Google results for your name and your name plus degree. So if you go into the search engines and you type in your name and see what comes up, and type in your name and city if your name is more common, and then see what comes up. And ideally, those first 10 on the first page would all be you or something about you. It'll be your website, your Facebook, your LinkedIn, your Twitter. So even if you don't post on any of those platforms, at least if you have your username reserved and you add a picture, you add a little bit of content so that you know you have some presence there, that can go a long way to helping you own the results for your name. Now, it won't always work. Like in my case, there are a lot of Rachna Jains because you know all of India has a lot of people you know with that same name. So what happened initially was I owned all the results for my name, but then over time, because Google's always trying to give more relevant results, it started to pull in results from other people with my same name. So there's been a little bit of dilution there. But in a local business, you know, I work online as well. So in a local business for your city, your state, you should own all of the listings. And the best way to do that is to have your own website, to have profiles on the big social media platforms, Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, Instagram, possibly Pinterest, possibly. And even if you don't use them fully, but just to reserve your username, keep it consistent. So always use your name and your degree or just your name locally. And the thing about responding to bad Yelp reviews is there's always a 50-50 chance that it's going to go out of control. So you respond, the patient responds again, you might respond or you might leave it, and sometimes it can go out of control. So the reason that the Yelp reviews can be problematic is because Yelp is a high value site. It's an authority site. And so one of the best ways to manage it, I think, is to kind of allow the review to be there, but invite clients, if it's appropriate, to leave positive reviews for you so that your only mention online isn't all negative. There are actual reputation repair strategies that can help you get all of the listings in your own name on the first page. And most people don't search past that. So I had a client once who was a physician and was accused of malpractice, and he was cleared of that. But there was a lot of news stories local about that person. So when you looked up his name, those stories would come up first. Mm-hmm. And so he had no social media presence. So one of the first things we did was set up all of these profiles that I'm describing. We started to add content to them, and it took a while, but ultimately they made the news stories drop to second page and then start to drop out of search. So there are ways to actively manage it, you know, if necessary. But one of the best preventive strategies is to build these profiles and have them filled in and ready so that when people search for you and your name or you and your name and your degree, you have these authoritative sites with your name and some information about you on them.
Yeah, I think the Yelp stuff can be so hard because they're, you know, at least for Curt and I as MFTs in California, we can't ask for testimonials from our clients and right. We can't, you know, there's no confidentiality. You know, we have confidentiality. We can't say like, hey, you know, that you weren't a client or you were a client. Like, I mean, I think there's arguments and that's much more of a nuanced conversation. But there's a lot of people who would not own that profile because, well, I don't want to have Yelp because, and it's like, no, own the profile.
Yes.
You know, and you're saying own all of the profiles, make sure. And I think there's a lot of people who will have Facebook with a cute name that's not theirs, and they'll have a lot of these other things and not actually build these professional sites. So I really like that idea because if you own it, then you also will see what's coming up. You'll actually get the notifications and understand what's happening there. But even just thinking about it in the search, wow, that's really smart.
It is, because in fact, for even new websites that go up, many times your Facebook profile or your Facebook page, if you have one, will rank higher than your own website. And yeah. It will rank higher than that for a period of time while your website gets, you know, indexed and things like that. So it definitely is wise to own the usernames and to claim your business in all the places that you can. So if you have a Pinterest profile, they have a business option where you can claim your business on Pinterest. And just a word about that too, is that again, the other mistake I see therapists making, and this isn't specifically about SEO, but it's about online marketing more generally, is they invest in these very expensive digital marketing packages that use YouTube, Pinterest, Instagram, all Twitter, all these kinds of things, and they spend a lot of money and they don't get any patients. So here's the thing about that, is that using those large sites, it's very unlikely, first of all, that a client is going to be searching for a therapist on Twitter. So if I need a therapist, I'm going to ask my friends first. If nobody has any recommendations, I'm going to ask my doctors or some, you know, professionals. If nobody has recommendations there, I'm going to search. I'm not going to go to Twitter and type in, you know, therapist in Maryland and then actually call that person. So this is one problem. Your clients are not there. The second problem is on those platforms, you have no way of targeting your local area. You can do it on Facebook, and I know that there'll be some therapist listening who'll say, well, I know someone who got a lot of patients from Facebook ads, and that was fantastic. And that's great. It does work for some people. But the kind of effort to benefit ratio for most therapists is going to be too high. So keep in mind that before you invest in some kind of marketing strategy, because, you know, ooh, you hate marketing or you don't want to do it, make sure that it's actually targeting your local area, and you would do better to use services and programs that are in your local area over investing in a big internet-wide marketing strategy when you can't take those patients from all over the country anyway.
I think that's so important, because there was a consulting client that I had who was like, I need to get more visibility, and I'm not a marketing coach. I do strategy, but she was talking about how she had this blog post go viral, and there were people all over the country who wanted to work with her, and she couldn't. And so, I mean, she had to do the decision, do I do a different service and do something like coaching or consulting that can go broader? But it was something where it was like she had invested in this kind of a strategy. And I don't know if she actually invested money, but she certainly invested time. And it was like, I had no local clients, but I had potential clients across the country. And it's like, okay, well, that could be the problem that you want to solve. Or it could be like, wow, I really just want a local therapy practice. What am I doing?
And it could be just a distraction, because then she had to research what she could offer, what she could legally offer. Maybe she had to get certification. And then you have to think that even if you're lucky enough to have one blog post go viral, I have a lot of concerns about whether that becomes enough of a basis for a sustainable business. You know, because I mean, and I'm not saying in this case that anything happened that way, but I just mean that people say, well, oh, you know, I had a YouTube video that had 2,000 views, and then they suddenly feel like that's some clue or some cue that they should, you know, do more videos. And then that's fine if you want to be a YouTube personality, that's fantastic. But there's a disconnect then between using that and growing your local practice.
We're kind of dancing around this investment of time. And I know that this is an answer that's going to wildly depend on what somebody's goals are. So I'll narrow this down just to people who are trying to get that local catchment and to get clients into their practice. But how much time should people be investing on a weekly basis to fostering good SEO, putting this kind of effort into it on a regular basis?
I would say that if you're a new business that has a new website that's not that well established, you're just starting blogging, you probably want to put one blog post up per week and more if you can. So let's say maybe it takes you a half hour to an hour to write that blog post and then optimize it. So at least 4 hours a month go there. And then you'll want to build directory listings for your business. And there are a lot of directory listings. So it just depends how aggressive you want to go. But let's say maybe 2 hours a month there, because again, that will want to be something that's consistent. You'll want to set up your Google My Business page, which will only take some time, one time, but that will be some investment. You want to be able to track your rankings. So if you're doing that manually, that will take a couple of hours to do each month to see how you're doing. And so I would say probably if you're going to do a kind of a full SEO effort for yourself, it would probably be between 7 and 10 hours a month. If you are a more established business, you've been around for a while, maybe that goes down to 5 or 7, 5 hours or 6 hours a month. But you can see that if you look at your hourly rate and you find therapy easier to provide, you know, for 5 or 6 hours of therapy a month, you could outsource the SEO, and, you know, so there becomes a point where the hours invested become more then might be worthwhile.
So add that to your to-do list, people.
I was hearing more like outsource your, I was hearing not put it on your to-do list, or maybe outsourcing is putting on my, putting that on my to-do list.
You know, because there are things that because I, you know, it, me or any other company that offers it as a service, we have certain efficiencies built into the process because A, we know what to do. You know, I have a rank tracking software, which would be cost prohibitive for a one person business to own. But because I can use it for all my clients, it runs automatically and I can check rankings. So I don't have to go in and do it manually, for example. I can track a lot more things. You know, I understand analytics very well. So you have to understand that too to see how your SEO is doing and is it resulting in visits and then conversions. So there's a lot to it. And, you know, I think with like with anything, you have to commit to it and practice it regularly if you want to be very good at it.
So I have one final question. It's probably we're getting beyond time. We have in our group, we have hashtag modern therapist. So these are folks who are thinking beyond therapy alone. They're potentially doing a lot of different things. So they're thinking bigger. And at what point does someone really need to have a larger focus on this if they do want to have an online presence? And what would that look like? Like, what would it look like if someone were really to dig in and have a big effort towards this? What kind of what does it look like? What would the results be? That was a long question too.
Yeah. So I think the first question sounded to me to be about when do people start shifting over from looking at themselves as sort of a local therapist to more of a thought leader or platform build, you know, looking to build platform online. So I think that was the first part of the question. And so what I would say is that obviously, it'll be unique to each person, but one of the things I would look for, one of the things I'd suggest people look for, is they look for a way where their practice as it is running fairly well. They have systems and operations in place that it's not requiring all of their time to keep the cash flow coming in. So maybe they've hired other clinicians, maybe they've hired an office manager, maybe they've outsourced billing or all of those things. They have to be sure that they can sustain their revenue generation and their profit margin while they're building their larger presence or looking to build their platform. Because the other part that nobody talks about is that building a platform is very expensive. And so not, you know, no matter who you work with or what you do, you're going to probably need a better website that's more professional and more geared towards your larger persona. You are going to need advertising and or SEO. You're going to need probably media access or media training. You are going to have to invest to write a book or publish a book or create a course or create a program, whatever it is you're doing. And then it's physically very expensive that if you get a lot of media interviews to travel to those interviews and be able to be on the Today Show and all these different things, it costs money. You need clothes, you need makeup, you need, you know, time away from home to be able to do that, to hotels and all that. So it's a costly proposition to look at building a larger platform. So it's very important that you have a revenue stream that feels solid and that can keep generating, you know, enough money. And it wouldn't hurt to save up, you know, to build your platform and make those initial investments. And then I think, you know, kind of the right time to start switching over is when you feel that you have developed an online audience, not just a local audience or a, you know, an in-person audience, but when you start to develop an online audience that you can say that you have maybe a 1,000 person email list, for example. And the reason I say 1,000 people is because I use the concept that Kevin Kelly developed. He was the past editor of Wired magazine, and he developed a concept called 1,000 true fans. And he took the example of a hypothetical music band, and everyone talks about this mythical six-figure business. I want to have a six-figure business.
Yes.
Right? And he said that if you have a band that has 1,000 true fans, each that spend $100 with them every year, whether it be on concert tickets or t-shirts or, you know, anything else, you know, music subscription or something, that band will be making six figures. And so I like that a lot because most of us can conceptualize getting 1,000 people to know us and us to know of 1,000 people. where, you know, it makes it much more manageable than coming in new and saying, I need to have an audience of 25,000 or 50,000 or 60,000. Yeah. How do you even find those people, right? But if you figure that you can make, let's say, 10 new connections a month, and you do that actively, that at the end of the year, you have 120 connections. You do that in year two, and it goes to 240 or more, because they know they have two friends and they have two friends.
Yeah.
So, you know, really, when you get to a point that you've generated maybe 1,000 people on your email list, where you've been able to test some products and services to them that have sold, you know, I think that's the time where you start to say that my idea has teeth and I can kind of take it forward.
Where can people go and hear more of you and find how to work with you?
My website is profitablepopularity.com. And so I'd welcome you to visit there. And if my message resonates, feel free to contact me.
Once again, thank you so much. And we will include links to Dr. Rachna's website in our show notes. You can find those on our website, mtsgpodcast.com. And this is, you know, such an important strategy for all of us as therapists, as business people. So this is such a great wealth of information. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
And until next time, I'm Curt Widhalm with Katie Vernoy and Dr. Rachna Jain.
Thanks again to our sponsor, The Therapist Leader.
The Therapist Leader was created to assist therapists developing their businesses beyond the one-to-one model in a strategic and sustainable way, using a three-pronged approach: refine, scale, and lead.
Refine your practice in a way that leverages your money, your time, and your life in such a way that leaves room to grow your business idea. Then scale your new business idea in a way that is aligned with your values, your lifestyle, and tunes out the noise of a busy online world of get rich and overstated marketing promises. And lead your business well. Leadership doesn't have to be scary, and leadership shows up in many ways in your business growth journey. Getting equipped is empowering and essential.
Get your free CEO workbook and accompanying e-course at thetherapistleader.com, which will walk you through 5 key shifts to make to grow the business of your dreams.
Thank you for listening to the Modern Therapist Survival Guide. Learn more about who we are and what we do at mtsgpodcast.com. You can also join us on Facebook and Twitter. And please don't forget to subscribe so you don't miss any of our episodes.